Well, thank you very much for having me here, first of all. Thanks, Howard. And, my name is Roberto Hermosillo. I'm originally from Mexico. I was born and raised there, and then I came to the U.S. to study guitar. I studied my undergrad with Christopher Parkening at Pepperdine University, and then I lived in Spain for a year. I'm a classical guitarist, and I also play contemporary styles of music, like some of the guys who were sitting with me in the practice room heard me playing some, type of flamenco or jazz or stuff like that, which I think that it's been very beneficial for me as a classical guitarist, especially studying popular music, because a lot of the music that we play in the classical guitar is it comes from popular Latin American or Spanish music, right? Can we agree on that?
Yeah.
Yes? Okay, good. So, I'm gonna be playing some pieces for you guys, and then it would be nice to talk about the origin of the pieces, or where do these pieces come from? Because me as Latin American and as having lived in Spain, I was also fortunate enough to study some of these pieces. I lived in Mexico and I lived in Argentina, and I lived in Spain too, and I played some of those styles of music, and it's fun music too. So anyway, I'm gonna start off with some Spanish music for you guys. So, Can somebody tell me, I don't want to make this a class. I'm a college professor too, so I teach college, but I don't want to make this completely good. Can somebody tell me what the second piece consists of? Anybody? Malagueña? You guys know? You know that, right? And Asturias is a Malagueña. Part of this piece that I just played is a Malagueña. That part is a Malagueña. And this piece, I feel like in order to interpret it well, you have to first listen to a Malagueña, and second, listen to a flamenco singer. Because the second part, I believe, is the singer coming in. The piece is called Rumor de Copla. In Spanish, Rumor de Copla means rumor of copla, which copla is a song, a southern Spanish song. And I think that once you actually, and from living there and listening to flamenco players, you can really understand what is happening in the piece. It's like the guitar comes in here, right? Malagueña. And then the singer comes in, a flamenco singer. Start to think of as these kinds of songs, of pieces, which are really songs, they have a melody, right, as reductions of actual music or other music like flamenco, you can really understand it, because if you've never listened to flamenco, I think it would be a little harder to interpret this piece, whereas if you separate, okay, this part is the guitar, and this part is like the singer coming in, then I think that you can really, really express a piece the way it's supposed to be expressed, or the way that Torrevine sent it to play it. And I've heard, you know, videos of Segovia saying that guitar is a small orchestra. I don't know if you guys have heard that before, but it is a small orchestra. And we get to have the guitar and the singer playing at the same time. And I think that that's something very unique that we have in this instrument. And if we don't take the time to study the fact that this music comes from flamenco, I feel like it might be a little difficult to make it sound really authentic. And I think that that should be our goal as classical guitarists, to make the music sound as authentic as we want. Our goal is not to sound like a flamenco player, right? Because we're still classical guitarists. It's still a style that is supposed to sound in a certain way. However, we borrow from flamenco in this piece. So I think that that's a way to incorporate it in that sense. Now I'm going to play a piece from Venezuela by Antonio Lauro. Do you guys know Antonio Lauro? Great composer. This is a Venezuelan waltz, and then I'll explain how I think it works. Number two, by the way. The two main popular styles that Antonio Lauro, I studied with somebody that studied with Antonio Lauro. And Antonio Lauro was actually are you guys familiar with that composer, by the way? Antonio Lauro? Yes? Okay, cool. One of my older teachers is from Venezuela, and he was Antonio Lauro's student. And I got to play a lot of Venezuelan music for years, like Pasillo. Like all that Pasillo stuff. And he taught me how that music actually comes from bandola, which is joropo and Venezuelan waltz. And joropo, you can really tell that Antonio Lauro was thinking about that music. Antonio Lauro actually played in trio music. He was a popular musician for years. You guys know trios, like three men with guitars come to the balcony and serenade a lady? Antonio Lauro actually made a living doing that for years. And he used to play that kind of stuff. So when I hear this kind of music, I know that he was really meaning to do. That's the actual rhythm of joropo, which we'll be playing in a tiny, tiny little guitar with four strings called bandola. So I think it's very important to, that's just my opinion, right? To listen to joropo, listen to how bandola sounds like, because Antonio Lauro wrote that thinking about that little instrument, and that's why we have these rhythms. And I think that if you want to make it sound the way it should sound, it's good to go back and listen. Okay, bandola, joropo venezolano, YouTube. Everything's out there for free. So that's what I think, that if you like the music of Antonio Lauro, I will go back and listen to some joropo and Venezuelan waltz and learn how it's counted. Because it's in 6/8, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But the waltz part is actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The Venezuelan waltz is counted in 1. It's not counted in 6/8. It's written 6/8. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But it's actually counted in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Or at least that's how the people from Venezuela count it. And me as a non-Venezuelan, I look at that and I say, okay, maybe I should try to count it when I play like that to make it sound more authentic. So that's my take on that song. The next one is a Brazilian piece by Heitor Villa-Lobos that I love actually very much. It's Choro Number 1. Thank you. musicians, and it's a choro. It's a choro is. Choro typical number one, and I had a really good friend from Brazil who played original choro, which has it's played on a 7-string guitar, and they do this weird thing called bacheria, and I remember that it also comes from playing batucada. You know, batucada has these it's an ensemble percussion, and I played in a batucada before, and when I play this piece, I remember the zurdos, which are tum pa tum tum pa tum pa. Yeah. It's like those basses are. Those basses are. That's why you probably notice that I dance a little when I play. It's unintentional because.
Keep rhythm.
Mood, eh?
Huh?
Yeah. To keep rhythm.
Yeah, it's it. Yeah. I do that because I, when I was in Batucada Ensemble, we have to dance.
Yeah. Wait,
yes, you play, you dance and you play the drums at the same time. Boom, but you know all that. It's a show, and this music comes from that. And I think that playing batucada helped me. I don't know if to play it better, but to understand it better at least, because you live that culture for a little bit in the ensemble and. You hang out with Brazilian people, and it's at least I feel closer to that kind of music. If that I don't know if that makes any sense, but it helped me understand the music better. It's like you guys know the Rosinianas by Giuliani, right?
Yeah, yeah.
They're based on operas by Rossini. Mm-hmm. If you're gonna play a Rosiniana, I think that it would be good to listen to an opera by Rossini, right? I think it's the same way in this. It was like, I'm playing batucada, and then I would go back to playing this piece, and I was like, oh. It's the bass there. It's a tum, ta, tum, tum, pa, tum, pa, tum, tum, pa. It's it, the zurdos. And so, it's great. I recommend to listen to batucada ensembles, choros, samba, samba reggae, all that music is very, very helpful, I think, to listen to. Anyway, the next piece is tango, an Argentine tango. I lived in Buenos Aires for a lot of time, and I had a video that I want to show you, but we couldn't get it to work. And being a young street musician, classical, so people would be like, "What are you doing in the street?" But this piece reminds me of that. I don't know if you've ever been to Argentina, but it certainly takes me back. It's called La Muerte del Ángel, which means the death of the angel. And it's by Astor Piazzolla. Thank you. And as you guys know, that's where the flamenco also comes in handy. Right? Do you guys know how to do this? Huh?
No?
Well, I can explain. I'm asking so that I can explain it. There's two ways to do it. There's the abanico, which is three fingers. So up, then, so P-A-I. Like this with three, and then starting at it, adding the others. And the easier way, I think, and that sounds a little more even, is just to kind of leave, do one stroke down, but hit it twice, so. And when you leave certain distance, so you have to find your own distance depending on the dimensions of your body, right, and your hands. But there's certain distance in which it's gonna sound exactly in the middle of a triplet. So one strum, it always comes from your wrist, right? It has to be like this, always. Because I can do that forever. I can. There's actually a song that is an accompaniment, just like this. And I can do that forever. I'll never get tired. So I do one strum down, and the other one up. Until eventually, after practicing for many, many days, I'll get it to sound even, hopefully. Last one is just, following along the same lines, it's an American piece by Andrew York, Sunburst. And I think that I see a pattern. And are there any composers in the audience? People that write music? Because especially you guys who are, from Vietnam, I think I see this, you've probably seen this pattern already, that a lot of composers, Tárrega incorporated flamenco things into romanticism, Barrios incorporated Paraguayan music into romanticism, Lauro incorporated, everybody incorporated the music of their country. Andrew York is arguably one of the most successful composers for guitar today. And he incorporated the music of this country too. So it's a pretty simple pattern that you guys probably seen already. He incorporates jazz. He used to be a jazz player, actually. A jazz and a classical player. I've met him before, and I've asked him, like, one time they told me, can you entertain Andrew York for an hour? Go take him for coffee or something. I was like, sure. So I went and took Andrew York for coffee, and he was a jazz player. He's a very interesting man, and so he used to be a jazz player, and he learned to combine jazz with classical guitar. And I think there's no accident that he's so successful. He's combined something that people are really familiar with classical guitar, and he's very successful with it, I think. And I asked him of this middle section that sounds kind of like Pat Metheny. I don't know if you guys are familiar with it. Pat Metheny, the jazz guitarist. Have you heard of him? No.
Say it again.
Pat Metheny.
No.
No. He's a. There's a section in that piece that it sounds a lot like Pat Metheny's music. And I asked him, and he was like, yeah, he kind of borrowed it from me. It was like a wink, right? So he borrowed from jazz as well as which is an American music, right? As well as all these composers borrowed from the music from the country. So if you guys, I mean, it's amazing that you guys have this place just to start with, where you're, you know, working to preserve the culture of, you know, your own country. And I feel like all of us as immigrants are trying to do that. And I would encourage you to do the same with the traditional music of Vietnam and incorporate it with classical guitar. And I think that it seems to be a recipe for success, at least for all these guitarists. And, you know, thanks for having me here again. Thanks to Howard, and thank you to you guys. You seem like really awesome people, so it's good to play for you. And I'm just going to close by playing that piece, Sunburst, by Andrew York. I hope you enjoy it.